So feel free to put on your camera if you want to. This is a pretty relaxed section, talking about neighbours. And so my name is Ada Wong. I'm from Lane Cove Council. I'll be your host today. And we also have Susan Chan from Willoughby City Council, Mark Lubrook from the Australian Red Cross, and Alicia Lodge from Lane Cove Council as well. So we will be sharing with you what we achieved, what we learned in the Meet Your Neighbours pilot project in social cohesion, doing it in high density residential setting. And it's a project between Lane Cove Council, Willoughby City Council, and the Australian Red Cross. And lastly, we will want to share with you the Meet Your Neighbours toolkit developed as a result of this project. And Alicia, while we still got all the residents in here, Alicia is going to tell you what Lane Cove Council actually offers to our apartment buildings, making it more sustainable. So just mention that if you haven't heard me, this session will be recorded today and will be available for viewing afterwards. If you can put yourself on mute, there will be opportunities for questions at the end of the webinar. So in the meantime, if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the chat throughout the session and we'll answer them at the end. So before we start, I would like to acknowledge the country we're meeting here today, the traditional custodian of the land, the Cammeraygal people, and we pay our respects to the elders past, present, and emerging. So also before we're providing an overview of the Meet Your Neighbour project, what it is, I want to address some common challenges both Lane Cove and Willoughby community faces in terms of social cohesion. So both councils, Willoughby and Lane Cove, we're considered as inner city councils, with majority, about half of our residents living in apartments. So 52% in Lane Cove and 41% in Willoughby. So from our last well-being survey, both councils did to assess our residents' well-being now and into the future, we find that people living in an apartment are more lonely compared to people living in houses. They don't know their neighbor well and less likely to call on the help for their neighbors. And they're less likely to do things among neighbors and are less likely to volunteer. And studies also shows that while migrants in Australia make up 33% of residents living in Australia, they represent more than half of it living in apartments. So high density communities are also more culturally diverse. With the changing climate, we'll see increase in both occurrence and intensity of the extreme weather events, such as extreme heat, severe storms, and extreme rainfalls. Currently, government spent about 97% of the funding in disaster related to recovery efforts. Only 3% is building resilience. There is a strong need to build resilience before disaster strike and respond to the shocks and stresses we face every day. Increasing social cohesion is the key to building community resilience. When we reflect on our COVID responses, looking at how resilient a community is, it is often find that the more cohesive, more connected communities will adapt faster and recover faster. Connected community also promote well-being and mutual support in the times of crisis. So to address the need for more cohesive and resilient communities in high density and medium density residential setting, that the Meet Your Neighbour project actually have two streams. So that's the High Neighbour program and also the community-led resilience program. So while both programs promote neighbourhood connectedness and community cohesion, the High Neighbour program focuses on training and support volunteers to engage and connect with the neighbours. And community-led resilience program focus on asset mapping, identifying any place-based resilience issues, and helping residents to mitigate those issues. So the Meet Your Neighbour project, that's a collaboration between Lane Pro Council, Willoughby, and Australian Red Cross on both projects. We share our learnings and findings regularly, and we developed the Meet Your Neighbour toolkit, which will be able to replicate what we've done in this project at other apartment buildings. Now I'm going to hand over to Susan Chan from Willoughby City Council, and she's going to talk about the High Neighbour programs.
Thanks, Ada. I'm just going to share my screen. So my name is Susan Chen. I'm the Community Projects Officer in Community Development at Willoughby City Council. And I'll be sharing the High Neighbours project, which we're doing here at Willoughby, aiming to promote neighbour connections. As Ada said, we wanted to address some of those differences between people living in houses and people living in apartments. We wanted apartment residents to feel more engaged with their local community, to build a sense of place and a sense of community within their apartment building. We wanted residents to make meaningful connections with each other. And we wanted residents to feel empowered to take action to increase connectedness and resilience in their community. So when we trialled this project, we piloted it at two sites. So there's the Bentley Apartments in Chatswood and Metro Towers. They're both in the central CBD area of Chatswood. And Metro Towers is right on top of Chatswood Interchange. There's three high-rise towers that's connected by a podium level. So they're both quite large high-rise sites. The first events that we did at each apartment building were run by council. So we did these Meet Your Neighbours events where all the residents were invited to attend this informal get together to have some food, to chat to council staff and to chat to their neighbours as well. And it was a good opportunity for us as council to ask residents to get if they were interested in being further involved with this project. And once we recruited some resident volunteers, they began to meet regularly. So with the support of council staff, they began this journey of coming up with their own ideas to promote neighbour connectedness and community in their building. So the residents completed asset mapping, they brainstormed ideas, and they started to deliver their own events and activities. So some of the events and activities that the residents organised include neighbours barbecues, cultural celebrations are always a great opportunity for people to get together. So there was a Diwali celebration that the residents put on, high-rise Halloween, where they decorated the building with spooky decorations, and the kids did high-rise trick-or-treating. There's a regular weekly walking group, Christmas and end of year parties, and outdoor kids games days as well. So across the two apartment sites, the residents delivered over 15 resident-led activities with over 700 cumulative participants who took part. They also established two digital communication networks like WhatsApp chat groups or an online meetup page. And the Bentley residents also established a formal committee so that they could continue this work moving forward. So there was quite a lot that was achieved by the residents within a very short period of time. So I just want to offer some reflections from our pilot, some of the things that we learned. So this really requires an adaptable approach. So allow room to be flexible. There's not going to be a one size fits all approach. And with the two different buildings, we actually ended up adopting quite different approaches, because even though these are two very similar sites that are located quite close to each other, they were actually two different, very, very different community contexts. There was a lot of learning through trial and error. So just to find out what works for your specific building. And this was really a journey that the residents went through, trying to learn the best way to promote their events, learning things that worked and didn't work, learning how to work together as a team. And there were definitely a lot of setbacks and challenges along the way. And then lastly, your building and strata management are going to be key stakeholders throughout this process. You'll need their permission and support to implement a lot of these activities. So it's important to get them on side from the very beginning and to have them understand the objectives and the purpose of what you're trying to achieve. And I just want to share some of the experiences from project participants. So people through this project have told me that they have noticed a shift in their building. So I talk to people in the lift now who I may not have met before because I know it's not a big deal. You feel more comfortable and I think it creates a better atmosphere in the building. A lot of neighbours didn't know each other, but they have managed to find new friends in the building. So it's through these events and activities, creating those opportunities to connect, we've been able to see a gradual shift. And it might not be immediate, but definitely over time, we've been able to see these connections happen. So a few more experiences. From the resident volunteers. I'm very proud of the fact that we've managed to come together as a group and build a community for each other. And also once I started to get involved, it definitely lifted my confidence to see, wow, I am capable of doing this. So the residents have really gone through a journey of learning how to put on events, how to work together with other residents to make something happen for their community. So I just wanted to share these experiences from the residents. And that's pretty much a very brief overview of our project at Willoughby Council. Feel free to drop questions in the chat. I'm happy to answer them as well. And I will hand back over to Ada.
Thanks, Susan. So you should be seeing my screen now. So I'm going to talk about more on the Meet Your Neighbor project. So this is the community resilience project portion that I'm going to talk about. So what we did is how it comes about is a partnership with the Australian Red Cross. So it was through the discussion with the Australian Red Cross, we wanted to increase community resilience, what they have done previously that works, we want to replicate in the urban area. So they have something called the community-led resilience teams that actually work very well in the rural area at the moment, and which was a program that actually residents come together to talk about resilience issue. Rural area is more prone to like a natural disaster, and they also the resilience team is actually a coordination between response agency and the residents as well. So this is a program that we're trying to replicate in the urban area. And at that time, it was about May last year when we just coming out of COVID. So we see the need in bringing residents together. I start talking and decrease that social isolation we have been for a long time. That's why this project is targeting social cohesion and as well as resilience in medium to high density. So Lane Cove and Red Cross, actually we run this program at three apartment buildings. So the landmark is very high density, about 50 floor. At St. Leonard's, just right next to the train station. And then we have Savannah apartment and Elena apartment, about maybe sixth floor or seventh floor at Lane Cove North. So just telling you a bit about the process of what we did. The process of engaging, first of all, is hosting a series of casual breakfast. We find that breakfast works because that's the time when people can still do their own thing, like, you know, usually like, you know, after their breakfast. So they come here from 9 to 10 on a Sunday morning. And then we find that that's the better engagement than Saturday because that's a lot of kids sports on Saturday. And the first engagement is just purely social. We give residents like a bingo card to provide opportunities for them to get to know someone new, not just someone they know already, but someone new as well. And then the second one, we put out maps and plans of the buildings and asking residents to highlight what safety related and resilience related issues that they see living at the apartment. And then we put forward an online survey afterwards, after gathering all the issues, and then we send it back to the residents. Now we want you to vote on your top priority. And the last engagement is putting solutions forward for those top five or six priorities that residents actually identified. So Mark from Red Cross is going to talk more on the particular issues at Elena and Landmark afterwards. And we also find that throughout the engagement, people really likes to get together, and they have, those buildings actually have amazing, like, you know, amenities and communal spaces. It only makes sense for people get together to do their hobbies as well. So we created like hobby groups. So we asked, during the engagement, we asked people to like say what do they like to do in their spare time with their neighbors, and then what sort of timing they wanted to do. And at the same time, recruited volunteers to organize those hobby groups. And then since then, at the Landmark, we actually managed to engage like a free hobby group set up. So reflecting off what we learned, we find that people really appreciate the opportunity, especially in the apartment, to meet their neighbors. While talking to them, they mentioned that, like, you know, they actually see their neighbors like at the lift lobby, maybe downstairs at the swimming pool, but they might not actually go and talk to them and learn about the neighbor more. They just know their name but don't know about them. So it's a good opportunity for them to get to know each other and build that trust. Resilience issue isn't the most exciting topic to talk about. It's not in people's mind. So we find that it needs to make it fun. Previously at other apartments, we make it quite like maybe boring, like more workshoppy. And then we find that there's less and less and less people come. But having those like social, like purely like more social, like a gathering, people don't mind coming and they're discussing resilience issues as well. It's important to get your building manager and strata on board very early, because those are the people that can actually help you to advertise your event. They can put posters on the notice board along the lift. They can send emails, e-news, and maybe put a note block on the Facebook page on your building. And also supporting volunteers is very important. Now I'm going to hand over to Mark, who wants to tell you more about the Landmark.
Thanks very much, Ada. Look, I don't know what you mean when you say that resilience issues aren't fun to talk about, honestly. Look, I might, before talking about Landmark and Elena, I might just quickly tell you why Red Cross is involved in this project. So I'm a regional emergency service officer at Red Cross, and our role is to work with communities to help them to respond to emergencies. So think fires, think floods, power outages, earthquakes, and the like. But we're working with council on this project because we understand that the best way we can help communities to respond to emergencies is to actually support them in advance to be as prepared as possible. And a forerunner, if I can put it that way, to preparedness is connection. Because in the event of an emergency, a lot of people think that, oh, there'll be someone from a combat agency, there'll be someone from the police or from the ambulance or fire, or there'll be the SES or Red Cross or some other agency who'll be on hand to support us. And often that is the case. But the evidence shows us that it's most likely to be a friend or neighbour that is the first person to actually reach out to you and assist you in the event of an emergency before the emergency services or related agencies get to you in some way, shape or form. So the stronger the relationships are within communities, the more prepared people are, and then the more effective all of the response efforts are going to be. So that's why we're here. And as Ada said, we've worked across three vertical neighbourhoods over the course of this project across the Lane Cove area to date. And so I'm going to focus on two of those so far. So the first being Landmark. So Ada shared this. I'm going to reiterate what you've already said, Ada, a little bit. So Landmarks is a relatively new building. It's about 50 floors of really high density living in St. Leonard's, 5 minutes from the station, spectacular views, lovely building, lovely people there as well. The residents first moved in December of 2021, and then we waited, I think you could say, until the occupancy rate was at about 80% before we began to engage with residents. So we wanted enough people there to be able to have some meaningful engagements and meaningful conversations with residents. And since then, over the course of the last 6 months or thereabouts, we've had those three engagements with residents at Landmark. And as Ada said, the first was breakfast in August of last year. There was a really good turnout, I have to say. I don't think we knew how many people were going to be there. My recollection was sort of 70 to 80 odd people turned up for breakfast. Aided and abetted by the availability of food. It was a really good opportunity for residents to introduce themselves to each other. You know, sometimes you move into a building and you see the same people over and over, but you kind of miss that window to say hello and you don't then introduce yourself. So this was a sort of a slightly more formal opportunity. Well, it was informal, but a structured opportunity for people to say hello, to introduce themselves, to say, hey, I've seen you around the traps, but haven't said hello, and to begin to form positive neighbourly relationships with each other, I think you could say. Then a month later, the second engagement took place, and that's where we asked asked residents to identify how their community was and was not resilient, I suppose, the positive and the negative. And we asked them to focus on three different areas, the first being the building or the physical infrastructure. The second was their social capital or the trust and relationships between residents. And the third was their prospective responsiveness to emergencies. And as a result of that engagement, residents identified about 20 different issues for consideration, including, for example, that some residents didn't know their neighbours particularly well. That's a fairly obvious one, but I think it was important for residents to identify that as an issue themselves. Some didn't know the emergency procedures for the building. Others did, but not everyone did, which was obviously a slight cause for concern, I guess, for those residents, for Strata, and for other partners in this project too. And look, there were concerns raised about safety in the car park, about dust, about cars going too fast, about the need for improved pedestrian access locally as well. So as I said, about 20 issues altogether that were raised. In the third engagement, rolling forward a couple of months, we highlighted the top issues that residents had raised and then asked them to share their prospective solutions to these issues. So it was a fairly simple, I think, but effective exercise. Ada organised for invitations to residents to attend another event. It was held in a common area downstairs outside of the building. Food was available again. And then under a gazebo, we had butcher's paper up with each of the key resilience issues kind of listed on a separate piece of butcher's paper. And then as people came through or residents came through to grab something to eat, we would grab them for a moment and ask them to come over to the gazebo and share their or have a look at the issues that they or other residents had raised and ask them to consider what solutions they thought could and should be introduced to respond to those issues. So these were issues raised by residents and solutions designed by residents as well. So we talked through the issues with them and then they grabbed a post-it note, sometimes multiple post-it notes, jotted down their response and whacked it up on the butcher's paper for the appropriate the appropriate issue. And all told, there were 27 ideas at Landmark that were suggested over the course of the morning, which we thought was a pretty good turnout. I mean, a number of those people, I guess, had a look at it and went, oh, that I would have thought the same idea. So you put a little tick to say that, you know, someone had had a same idea as someone else that already suggested. So the results were then written up and presented to Strata. And from these engagements, there were a number of outcomes. Ada mentioned the hobby group. I think that was important. So a social or hobby group or hobby groups perhaps were established. And I think, again, a really good opportunity for residents to get to know each other, to build relationships and form the foundation for resilience across the building. And they've since begun to run a number of activities, tennis, board games, table tennis, and they're running autonomously now. So the residents are communicating through WhatsApp, which is fantastic. And obviously the idea. Strata also advised us of the responses they had already taken in response to some of the issue, or were already taking rather in response to some of the issues. So installing speed bumps in the car park to try and get cars to slow down to improve the safety of pedestrians in the car park. They advised that they were communicating with residents about how to minimise issues with windy balconies. That was an issue that a number of people raised and were concerned about, with sort of just the height of the building, a lot of wind, and then the potential for furniture and other things to blow off balconies. So so the Strata advised that they were communicating with residents, providing some advice about what they could do about that issue. And they also began to introduce a procedure to support more vulnerable residents as well. So asking them to self-identify to the building manager. So in the event of an issue, the building manager would have their details on hand and could ensure they received support if and when necessary. So in response to all of the ideas that residents raised, Strata also committed to a number of additional actions over the course of the year ahead to try and address resilience issues for the residents at Landmark. And these included running a defibrillator training for residents and staff, doing some more fire warden training for residents too, organising some small get-togethers of residents, 5 floors at a time is my recollection. Remembering that it's almost a 50-floor building, so there is a lot of residents and very, very hard to get to know a lot of people. So they were breaking it down into 5 floors and sending people invitations to come together and get to know people on their floor and adjacent floors. They're hosting a Get to Know Your Strata Committee function as well, and organising a Christmas function. So lots of things, I think, happened and are happening at Landmark as a result of the project, to build relationships, identify issues and then and solutions, and try and introduce some of those solutions, again, to build resilience across the building. So I'm probably not going to have time to talk about all 3. So I'll quickly mention Elena. That's the another apartment building or vertical community that we worked in. So that's about 6 kilometres, I think, to the northwest of Landmark. It's in a medium density building, 6 floors in Lane Cove North. It was an unusual situation insofar as almost everyone moved in at the same time in that building, which was great, actually. It meant that there were some relationships that already formed. Most people moved in around February 2022, and most of the residents there were and continue to be owner-occupiers as well, which made, I think, our job a little bit easier than it may otherwise have been. Similar to the Landmark, together with Lane Cove Council, we ran 3 events for residents. Again, breakfast for residents to get to know each other. A second session where we asked residents to identify those issues to build their resilience. And at that second session, residents identified 16 issues, including concerns about the number of false alarms that there were in the building, some challenges around access to fire doors, a lack of clarity about evacuation procedure, some concerns around safety with the pool. But for a smaller building with fewer residents, 16 issues, like, we thought was a good outcome. And then from that, we asked people to vote on which of these issues were most important to them, and they identified the top 6. And then we went back for that third engagement, where again, with butcher's paper and post-it notes, we asked residents to have a look at each of the top issues that they had identified and come up with some solutions, and then jot those down on the post-it notes and stick them up on the butcher's paper. And once again, that information was then presented to Strata. They've clarified where some of those issues they were already aware of and have some, and already undertaking steps to fix them. But they've also made some commitments to fix some of the other issues, including improving some of the safety features at the swimming pool, particularly for kids, filter guard, signage and things like that. They're interested in installing a defib machine at the gym as well, because there isn't one there at present. They're going to host ongoing social gatherings, including a board games group, movie nights and a Halloween event as well. And also a system to identify vulnerable residents who may need assistance from fire and rescue in the event of an evacuation. In that instance, sort of a list is going to be stored at the fire panels to identify those apartments that need assistance in the event, as said, of the need for an evacuation. So there are some similar themes that emerge, even though these two communities were very different from each other in terms of the density of living and where they were in the LGA. There were a number of similar issues that popped up, I think, and a number of similar solutions, which was interesting. I think I probably need to wrap up and hand over to Ada, but all in all, I think at each location, we were incredibly encouraged by the relationships that have begun to be developed, by the issues raised and the responsiveness of both the residents and the stratas as well. And I think we're confident that these vertical communities are more resilient, or beginning to be more resilient than they would otherwise be if it weren't for this intervention or this project with council. So Ava, back to you to talk about
Your Neighbours. Just going to go through like a little bit about the Meet Your Neighbour toolkit, which you can actually download it using the QR code, and then I'm also going to scan it, send it to an email that I'm going to send after the event. This will be helpful for residents that receive the grant from the council while they're hosting the Meet Your Neighbour party in Langkawi as well. So this is actually a guide with tips, ideas, and downloadable templates on how to get to know your neighbour better and how do you develop resilient neighbourhoods. So there will be ways, suggested ways to meet your neighbours, social gatherings, activating a common space, how do you set up a hobby groups, and the process of identifying and resolving resilience issues. So just showing you a few templates there you can download. So the vertical community asset mapping, can do a bingo card, barbecue checklist, event plan, project plan, a poster template, meet your neighbor dietary. After you meet your neighbor, you can put their details on the fridge, and a Meet Your Neighbour card as well. So there's also a workable template to identify resilience issue that Mark and I used at the events. So while we still have you today, and we know that many apartment buildings and residents are here, I wanted to stay online. Alicia is going to help to introduce a few apartment-related sustainability and waste programs that are available to the Lane Cove residents and strata. Thanks, Alicia.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming along today. Those presentations were awesome. And there is a question in the chat, so we'll get to that afterwards. Just thinking about if you're doing your parties coming up soon, your street parties, you might not want to jump straight into sustainability with everyone, but have it in the back of your mind for once you build those relationships about some fun projects that you might be able to do together. So on the next slide, we have the Greener Apartments Program, which is a program that council offers to any apartment building. It's a free program, and council will pay for an independent expert to come and do an energy and water assessment for your building. So they're going to look at things like your operating costs, your common area energy usage, your gas usage, water usage, and the greenhouse gas emissions of all these things, of course. So they give you a report, and that comes back with the best advice for your building. So this might include things like how to put solar on your building, how to install an EV charging station. And it will, of course, include the financial case for doing all these things so that you can actually go to your strata and say, this makes economic sense to do so. And so our friendly council team of sustainability and resilience gurus will be there as well to help you implement anything, as well as the independent consultant. So Any of these ideas that come forth in the report, you can pick up the phone and chat to us about them at any time. So on the next slide, you can see we've had 60 apartments. Ada, can you just change to the next one? Yeah, thanks. We've already had 60 apartments go through, apply for this program. And some of the actions that they've been able to achieve is getting like LED upgrades, motion sensors, smart meters, and things like that. So the reports also showed that in many cases, a strata itself can save about $5,000 on average per year by putting up the solar. So this is a great savings. And on the next slide, in case you don't want to just, have that solar for the common area, you could also consider having it for some really keen residents as well. So there is a way of doing it so that the solar can be put on and it can be split fairly between residents who help pay the capital for that solar to be put in place. It works best usually in medium rise buildings or low rise buildings, but yeah, it's still quite a good one to consider if you have some residents who want solar for themselves, as well as the common area strata. So it just might make sense to do it at the same time. So the idea of this solar sharing gateway in the green box there is that it will get all the energy from the solar panels and divide it evenly amongst everyone. So you don't have to worry about one panel maybe getting more shade than the others. It's not one panel per unit or anything like that. They've got technology now to divide it up equally. So that's just something else to consider. So on the next slide, quick poll. Put your hand up if you've gone downstairs to the bin and discovered that a neighbour has placed the wrong thing in the recycling bin. This happens to me all the time in my building. And so another fantastic thing that my colleague Ruby has just launched is the Apartment Waste Improvement Program. So Ruby will come to your building and chat with you about any issue that you might have. So it might be contamination in the recycling bins, like the wrong thing in there, maybe not enough bins, maybe bins that need to be repaired. And so she can provide stickers that will make it easier for the residents to know what goes in each bin, and also larger signs for communal bin rooms. And after the initial assessment, Ruby is going to also check in with you regularly. So, and then finally, this one's open to everyone, not just apartment dwellers, anyone. We'd really love for everyone to get involved in whatever capacity they have. So if you really want to reduce impacts of climate change, but you're not sure where to start, and if you prefer working together with other like-minded community members, then come and join the Sustainability Collective. So it's a new group for volunteers that are working collaboratively to develop projects and ideas that will reduce emissions. So you can come up with your own ideas and your own things that you want to do. The commitment is just 4 meetings a year, and then you decide how much time you want to put on these projects in between the meetings. So in our first meeting, we're going to come up with a plan for our mission statement and some initial projects, but it could include things like talking to people about solar, going electric, composting, and other ideas that might come to the table. So registrations are open. The first meeting will be announced in a month or so. So if you're interested, please sign up and share the word, and we look forward to creating positive changes with you. So did you want me to read some of the questions to you, Ada, in the chat?
Yes, please.
Sure.
We're going to go through some of the questions now. I'm just aware of time, so we'll go through hopefully all of them. And then we're going to stay behind for those who have further questions.
Yes, so if you have any questions, there's just the one in the chat at the moment from Sky. It says, do you expect the street parties that are not in apartment dwellings to do resilience boards and affiliation clubs too? And just wanting to understand the expectations on the street party organisers.
The expectation of the grant?
Yes.
No expectation of the grant actually to do any resilience activities. Because usually the first one is more social. And we want to keep it social so that people think that it is fun to do it. And this is the council do this because we wanted to build resilience in those apartment buildings. So this is unrelated to the grants that we're giving out. The grant is more to connect with your neighbors. But council is keen to work with any street or apartments who wants to build resilience as well. And then we can probably connect on how can we take this further.
There's another question in the chat about the size of the grant for the different apartment size blocks. So if you have, 400 people in your apartments, is there a way of allocating the grant in a different way?
So 300 is the maximum we're going to give, but for smaller apartment blocks, we're actually giving less than 300. And we want to make this sustainable. And we know that people host their street parties and apartment parties already, but this 300 is actually sort of a treat or something just to entice people just to start thinking about street parties. And the response that we get actually shows that Lane Cove are actually very community minded. We got more than 70 applications within 3 days. And we can't give out the grant to everyone, unfortunately, but we have given out 50 of them, both in streets and at an apartment.
And the last one's just a comment here that they're going to share the recording with their strata. So that's fantastic because, the more people that know about the toolkit, the better.
Oh, actually, I find that some of the questions is actually just directly to me. So I think Deborah at the very initially, she asked, will you share what worked and what didn't? So I think in my presentation, I did. I don't know whether Susan, do you have anything to add to what worked and what didn't in your project?
Like I said, it might vary from building to building. But something that we've learned is putting posters up in lifts and lift foyers have worked fairly well because people are kind of forced to look at it. That was one thing that we felt really worked. And when something doesn't work, to just not get disheartened by it and to just maybe reflect on that and keep going, because our resident teams definitely had a few events where maybe things didn't go quite the way they expected, but they just sort of brushed it off and moved on to the next event. So that's something I could share.
And then let's see whether there's anything more. So how do we get to do this in our buildings? I live in Meriton, and this would be amazing. I think it's from Deborah. So council is happy to actually connect with you directly on how we can do this together in the next year. Yep. I think I'll have your email address in the registration. And
another one here just asking for a clarification on the word resilience. Just because they've moved from another country, so they're not sure if it's a different terminology here in Australia. So maybe have you got a definition on hand of resilience, Ada?
So in terms of resilience, it's very broad. It could be personally how resilient you are, to crisis that you deal with. But in terms of the building that we work with, the resilience is defined as emergencies. Emergency response, that kind of resilience we're talking about. So we're not talking about your personal resilience. We're talking about sort of as a whole building in terms of dealing with crisis, how resilient is your whole building is.
Yeah, so it's kind of like getting prepared for emergencies and being able to bounce back. So the more prepared you are, the more likely you are to bounce back. Last question here. I think this is just a comment, unless you have any more in your personal one, Ada, just about when they do more community meetings and they talk to their neighbours about recycling and waste. So that's good.
I think that's it on my direct. If we missed your question, you feel free to turn on your voice, unmute yourself. Otherwise, we're going to close this webinar.
Well, actually, Ada, there might be one more. Do we have any examples of the High Neighbour program for more child-orientated communities, or one being more organised or scheduled?
Yeah, sure. So yeah, like I mentioned, they were two different communities. So if you're asking about what examples of what those differences were, I'm not sure if that's your question, but it was things like how long have the residents been living there, and so then that sort of impacts on how cohesive that that community is going to be, and also how willing are the residents to put in the time and the work to organize activities. That also, because it is a lot of work that the residents are volunteering their time for as well.
I was just going to say, I popped that question in because when I've been at other webinars, I've found that some communities are really organised and they like all that organisation, but ours are really a bit more random. So it's sort of like, yeah, we have to create programs where people can just do it when they've got a minute.
Absolutely.
So you'd have to, like, you're right, you have to be really flexible because you just don't know how time poor your people are, or, you know, some people just want to do some work but they don't want to meet a whole lot of other people because they're a bit introverted. Yeah, so you just to highlight that everybody's a bit different and you just try some things, and if it doesn't work, that's okay, you just move on and try another thing, and you just keep, you know, keep trying things, and sometimes the unexpected things are the things that work.
Yeah, absolutely. And that was definitely the experience actually in both buildings. Even the most active communities were still sort of doing things on the fly, and it's not as scheduled. They, you know, they had really great ideas about doing monthly get-togethers, or, you know, creating a calendar a year ahead, and, you know, sometimes those things just don't quite work out. Great comment.
I think the more volunteers actually you get, like, the more maybe focused you can be, like, following a plan, like, even though, like, someone, like, a lot of personal commitment actually changes throughout time, but if you have, like, you know, like a big core team, then smaller teams can run as well.
Yep.
So as Alicia and I mentioned, like, our Lane Cove Council is very keen to work with apartment complexes. Speak with your neighbours and strata, contact myself, I'm Ada Wong, like, if your building is interested to work with council and expand the Meet Your Neighbour project at your apartment. And if you're keen in the Greener Apartment Growth Grants or the WASTE program, then do contact Alicia. Our details will be in the email sent to you after the event with the Zoom link and also with the toolkit link as well. So thanks very much for attending the webinar today, and have a good afternoon.
Thanks, bye.
Thank you. Thanks,
bye.
Everyone.
Bye, everyone.